Good evening, friends. Today we have got a very interesting guest with us who changed the parameters of retail business in this country. He is a gentleman who conceptualized, created and made successful the brand called Shoppers Stop. I'm sure each one of us would have been a customer or a first citizen of Shoppers Stop. So he is the gentleman. A great journey. Mr. B. S. Nagesh, a great journey from 1991 to 2011. Now he sits on the board, but we are going to discuss a lovely journey that he could do and bring a revolution in this country as far as retail business is concerned. You'll be surprised to know, friends, today all across India, Shoppers Stop operates in 45 lakh square feet. An enterprise which started with him. He is in fact the first person on the board of Shoppers Stop to begin that initiative. 45 lakh square feet in India, across states, across the country. At the same time, it has got more than 18,000 employees. And this large organization of 45 lakh square feet began with only 2,800 square feet on Andheri SV Road. Everybody must be knowing it. Once upon a time, we were the all of us would have been customers at some point of time in our lives. So Mr. B.S. Nagesh, we are going to extract the best of his experience. First, I will take the opportunity and then he's all yours. So let's begin, please. So beginning a journey in around 1981-82, sales has been his forte all his life. He began with Blowplast, then he went on to the electronics television industry, then he was handling around 128 stores for Corona shoes across the south and the east of India, right? He's been a railway family person, his father was in the railways, he lived all his life in Gorakhpur, so he was not in any urban part of the country, he was from Gorakhpur, and we all know the scenario in those kind of places. He's a student of the Banaras Hindu University, BHU, and I think phenomenal knowledge. When he came to Mumbai, that was his first time in Mumbai. He saw Mumbai for the first time, and he joined Shoppers Stop with a mission to make it a 50,000 square feet store. He didn't stop at 50,000 square feet. He went on to make it 45 lakh square feet from 1991 onwards. And he also brought in Hypercity, which is considered as one of the top 100 destinations for shopping across the world. He's done a lot of international activities also. We will all unfold it during our conversation. So Nagesh, thanks for being here.
Thank you very much.
I'm sure you have got a great inspiring story. People would love to hear you. He's a phenomenal orator. He has been speaking on international and national forums. And today we are going to enjoy all his experiences. So Nagesh, what do you say after this great long journey? Retail, when you began, was more traditional retail in this country? I think we must be the country with the maximum number of traditional retail businesses. And you got into modern business.
Yeah, India is probably a nation of shopkeepers. If you look at it, we have close to about 10 million retailers. So 1 crore retailer for 120 crore population. So you have almost one retailer for every 120 beings in India. I don't think we can get any better than this. So we are a nation of shopkeepers. And when I came into Mumbai didn't have the so-called modern retail, but they were very good retailers. I mean, Amarsons, Premsons, Akbar Ali's. I mean, they were all very, very intelligent retailers, Nullies in the south. But this was also unique from one point of view that I was an employee of the company. So probably only retailer in the world which has been started by an employee for a family. Otherwise, all retailers start with the family and then give it to an employee. So unique proposition. Interesting, you mentioned Gorakhpur. Yeah. And actually, before I came to Mumbai, I could speak Bhojpuri very well. Mumbai has actually taken away my Bhojpuri. But also, when I started speaking Bhojpuri, people started calling me Bhaiya. So I said, let me not get into that part of mine. And well, Gorakhpur is a phenomenal place. We used to have my classmates used to come on horses into the classroom, right up. The horse used to be parked outside the classroom. So
without number plates.
Without number plates. Without number plates, you know. It's an amazing journey from Gorakhpur.
How was the transition from your 128 stores across the country to one location to begin with. What experience did you carry forward from your past 10 years of three organizations to Shoppers Stop in 1991?
See, Rajesh, this was totally different for me. I mean, running a 500 square feet to dreaming to run a 50,000 square feet was very different. So what did I have or what did I bring on the table was, I was always a very employee and customer-centric person. So whether I did in my college my projects or did in Corona, for me, everything in an organization is either customer-centric or employee. No, it is customer-centric and employee-oriented. And actually, that has been the biggest help for me. Retail is nothing. It's all about people. So you learn from people and do for people.
The First Citizen apparently happens to be the largest customers, you can call it as a club, First Citizen Club in the country. It has more than 3.1 million people as members. You started Shoppers Stop in 91 and you started the First Citizen Club in 92, 93. How did that idea emerge?
Well, this was not an idea. Shoppers Stop is the child of an ignorant CEO, me. I mean, I had never run an apparel business. Mujhe ye bhi nahi pata tha ki collar size kya hota hai aur waist size kya hota hai. So I started off like that. So the only way I could learn was I used to meet customers every day. I used to be standing outside and talking to customers and ask them. And after some time they said, yaar poochte ho, time barbaad karte ho. So I thought this is a problem. So I started saying, sir, ek kaam karo, apne chit pe ek naam likh ke de do. Main lottery nikalunga, 100 rupees ka gift voucher denge. So it started off like that. And it went on. My secretary resigned and a new secretary joined. And she said, Mr. Nagesh, there is a carton lying in your room which has got this white papers. So shall I throw it? I said, get it. So there are 40,000 chits in that with name, address, and that time there was no email or no mobile number and landline number. I said, yeah, these were our first customers. Why don't we put it into a database? So actually it was an ignorance, knowledge-seeking employee who collected the addresses of the customer. They were our first customers, so I called them First Citizen. And it started with 40,000, it's 4 million. Today, 73% of the business comes from them. So out of 4,000 crores, 3,000 crores comes from just these known customers. So, I mean,
wow, that's phenomenal. So we all, I guess we all hear about data mining. He started customer mining in the year 92, 93 itself. So I think accidentally you came out on a solution and you really converted into a big business opportunity of captive audience. I'm sure you would have taken the help of technology to definitely do the customer mining situations. Which year did you think that technology will be a big help for the expansion of your organization?
Honestly, when I was joining Shoppers, somebody told me Rehejas mein computer use karte hain. So I had never seen a computer. Okay, it looked so ignorant in 1991. So I went to my neighbor and said, he was a techie. I said, show me what it is. So we started from that point of time. 1998 is when actually we bought probably the world's best technology called JDA. I mean, we were a 28 crore company and we bought a technology for 7 crores at that particular point of time. But we realized that without technology, we can't progress. And the world's best retailers, and if you go to Infosys or go to Wipro, I mean, retail almost contributes 25 to 30% of the business. So retail and technology almost goes. Next to NASA, I think the maximum technology is used in retail today. Of course, now with the consumer mining and database, it's become very, very big. So I realized in 91 itself, but by the time we got really big technology was in 98.
How did you take on the Benzers and the Emersons and the Akbaralis of those times?
It was not very difficult. You know, for South Mumbai people, coming to Andheri is going to London. So they didn't want to come and I didn't want to get them. So it was as easy as that, you know. So honestly, Andheri Shoppers Stop was serving its catchment. And even today, we started with one. Today we have 11, 12, we can open 3 more stores. It's such a catchment business. And Mumbai is such a dense population. I mean, you can do any amount of business as long as you know how to serve your customers. So that's not a problem.
Once you made it big, how did you get into finance management? Because it was revenues coming in against the growth that you wanted. How did you balance that?
Well, one thing I must give hats off to the Raheja family. From day one, they didn't give me equity. Every money had an interest to it. So there was nothing called a free money. And I think that's something that all of us should learn. So you're made accountable for the money.
So the interest kept you interested?
Well, interest kept me disinterested from them because it was cheaper to borrow from the bank than to get from them. I hope this is not, oh, this is getting telecast also. So, okay. But now I'm a board member, vice chairman, so I can manage it now. Yeah, no, it was, so we always, one thing that I must say is, I always say that in an Indian market, you have to build capability before you build capacity. most of the organizations who have failed are the ones who build capacity and then try to build capability. It doesn't happen. So if you look at this, from 91 to 98, we had only two stores. We opened the third store in 98. And then we started building. So we were called the slow turtle of retail because we were slow. But today, we are one of the few standing up and have been a profitable retailer through and through. So to me, it's important to build capability and then build capacity. So you are never overspending. So for us, if you look at our balance sheets for the last 20 years, our debt equity ratio has been 1:1. Okay, and if you look at many retailers who stretch to 1:2, 1:3, 1:4, I think that's not the principle that we have worked on. And still we have grown at a CAGR of maybe 18, 19, 20% for 25 years.
Wow, and that is consistent.
It's been consistent, except for 1-2 years.
When in 2008 to 2010.
Yes, I mean, that was one of the failures. I have many failures, so don't ask me too many. But yes, that was one of the failures. Yeah.
When you started your organization, what was your team building parameters and how did you monitor that personally?
I never thought of it. You know, there were 12 of us.
Again, the ignorance helped you?
Yes, in fact, I must tell you, the first two employees that we took in the sales, when they came, and they were sales boys and girls, we call them customer care associate. When they came in, I didn't know what to ask question because I had no imagination what a 50,000 square feet store will be. So I kept quiet for 20 minutes. And they kept smiling, kept smiling, kept smiling. And after 20 minutes, I said, thank you very much. And they went away. No questions asked. Huh? I didn't know what to ask. I mean, but I'm not such a fool. But I'm just telling you in terms of the way it was built up. Then when they are selected, they asked, why are we selected? I said, 20 minutes without a question if you can smile. You can't be a better sales associate. Because for us, to teach smiling to an associate is impossible. Okay, you can teach them all the things. So I think this is how we actually built up. We were 12 of us who started off, and we never thought that they were employees. They were all family. And it was like a family business we started off. And it continued like that. Today also, if you look at it, every employee in Shopper Stop has a common designation. The only company in the world which has only one designation, from managing director to the front-end associate, is called customer care associate.
Wow, fantastic, fantastic. That's a good new learning. What I would like to also ask you is, in a retail business, you do two type of recruitments. One is you recruit your employees, whom you call a customer managing associate. And the other recruitment you do is the right vendors. You need to have the right vendors so that you can't go wrong on handling your customers. So what were your parameters and priorities when you engaged the recruitments of the right vendors?
So, see, we first of all, we don't call the vendors in Shoppers. They're called partners, number one. Number two is, generally when you call somebody a vendor and you work with him, you actually make him sit across the table. We said
and the same 20 minutes formula of smiling face?
No. Here you wanted a frowning face, you know, because we used to negotiate, you know, margin negotiation. So very few people used to smile when they were negotiating margin. But I must tell you that we changed the paradigm of saying that you are not opposite my table. I and you sit together to serve the customer. We never had an issue on the partnership. And Shoppers is very fairly well known for its partnership principle. And every year we meet our partners once a year. And every year we assess them through a methodology and we actually give them a score to say you have rated as this. It's like an open rate card, I mean open card. And they can ask any questions to the management. So vendors have never felt that they were somebody different. They were part of the Shopper Stop ecosystem. So it's worked very well. Very early in 1990s, we created a system where every vendor online could see his sales, stock, inventory and his accounts ledger on an online basis daily. So my vendors saw the information in Shopper Stop much before my employees saw it in the morning. Because employees used to get up at 9, vendors, entrepreneurs get up at 6 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, because he has got the receivables. Well, how was your feedback management system? The customers give the feedback to the sales team, the sales team gives the feedback to the management. How do you use that customer feedback system with your vendors?
Okay, I think one of the important things is that retail is a business where decisions have to be taken at the point of contact. So when it is vendors, it is our merchandisers. When it is customers, it is our front end. So very early, we actually said that what is the empowerment required for vendors and our merchandisers to deal, and our store managers and the customers to deal. Anything to do with customers stops at the store manager. The store manager need not come to a head office at all for any decision. I can give you examples, hundreds of them, where a store manager will take a call, give away a 10,000 gift voucher because he made a mistake. Okay, same thing goes with vendors. And there were some basic principles also that we fitted up. So for example, one of the values that we had in the company was, we will not take what is not ours. So no employee in the company, anybody right up to the top takes a gift. because we don't do that, so therefore this whole corruption that is there in the whole buying and selling system was absolutely eroded. In fact, there was a vendor who called me saying, aapke ek nahi buyer join ki hai, and she's asking for money. Maine usko bola ki agar main bol dunga to naukri chala jayega. So I said, wahin se bhej do usko. You have authorized to sack her. So he sacked a buyer of mine who was my employee because she was doing something which was wrong. So again, I'm saying it's all an approach of how do you work partner? Because the common cause is customer and not common cause is business. Business automatically happens.
What was the methodology that you adapted to make sure your thoughts percolate to the last man in the organization? And how did you build the ethics system in the organization?
So one is, I think, retail is a very transparent business. When you walk the floor, it's visible to everybody. Because you can't do something from the cabin. Dukandari peeche se nahi chalta, dukandari aage baith ke chalta hai. So everybody watches you. So you have to walk the talk. I think that's number one. Number two is this when we did this customer care associate, it actually equalized the whole organization in a big way. Because I may be the managing director as a function, but I am the same designation as you. That's the second thing that happened. The third is that every day morning would start with a town hall meeting, every day. The first 9 years, every employee in the shop was interviewed by me personally. Because my belief is, if culturally you have the right team, then nothing can go wrong. And culture building and value creation is probably the largest input that the managing director or the CEO has to build in the organization. Every human being comes to work wanting to perform. We believe that they don't want to perform. It's not true. You have a great culture, the organization works. Even today, at 10:45, across the company, 18,000 people sing the anthem of Shop Stop across the company from head office to the town. So we meet. We are like a family meeting. It's like family having dinner together. We have anthem together.
Fantastic. And as the organization grew, how did you manage delegation?
Well, for me, it was not about what I do. For me, it was about what they can do. And the only word I keep using is it is empowerment. Okay, everybody in the organization knows his authorities. Everybody in the organization knows what he can do or she can do. But since if you're an entrepreneurial family, then when you empower them, they take the right decision. And most of the decisions they took was much better than the decision I took because of the fact that they were empowerment. So I would very clearly use the keyword as empowered, full authority given to the employees. Mistakes were always allowed. Failure was encouraged, was never punished. And to me, that make a big difference. And this actually came from top. Like I said, I failed so many times. And people kept asking, why has Rahesh not sacked you? We have to go and ask him why he didn't sack me. But if he allowed me to fail, I can't stop others from not failing. It's better to try and fail than not to try.
Well, it's basically a very employee-engaged business model. So how did you avoid being poached, your people being poached? And how did you poach?
Well, the first is that for the first 4 years of the business, we did not take a single employee from either textile, garment, or fashion background. Not one person. Because the moment you take a person from anywhere, he says, ye nahi ho sakta hai. Because he comes with a baggage. We wanted people who could say, ki sab kuch ho sakta hai. And that, I think, really, really helped us. We always have developed people from below. If you look at Shoppers, there's a very good case study called the kangaroo system of training. So you will take people right from the bottom. So our sales associates have become store managers, general managers. 75% of the hierarchy is built within the company. And we had graduate trainees, management trainees. I mean, today, if you look at the management, I think the top three people have been in the business for the last 14 years, 20 years. Apna company kaun chhod ke jata? Aap apna ghar chhod ke jate ho kya? It just doesn't happen.
But we leave the home to go to a better home all the time.
Well, then he's actually carrying your brand. Let me tell you a story. One of my guys left Shoppers after 10 years and he joined the other company. And he was asked to give an inauguration speech. He said, welcome to Shoppers Stop. Because he totally forgot that he's joined a new company. He's so used to the brand. So when people leave and go somewhere, there are brand ambassadors there. And you know, people say, oh, you're doing a good job. Where did you learn? I learned in Shoppers Stop. So actually, if you encourage, they become a brand ambassadors. And sometimes such growth is good for the organization because you require fresh people to come in.
So you become a very fertile platform for the other people to poach from because you are training them from the scratch, you're making them great sales teams. So how did you avoid getting the teams poached? Because that is one of the biggest challenges that any service-based industry faces today.
No, but what is the worry of team poached? They are not bonded labor. I mean, why would you... See, why will a person leave? He'll leave you because he's unhappy with you.
So if you are keeping him happy, you don't have to do anything about it. And if he's leaving you, it is better he leaves. Why do you want to retain an unhappy person?
And what is the innovative incentive methodology that you adapt to make your teams entertained and interested in the organization?
We love him and he loves you.
Because and when you convert that into currency, does it appreciate?
Well, actually, it appreciates much more because rupee depreciates. Okay, and it really appreciates. I fully believe in it. I fully believe. But one thing is important. You need to pay market salaries.
Oh, there you can exchange love. Can you
be with your wife without giving a gift on Valentine's? A diamond necklace. Or
and especially when your wife feels that every day of the year is a Valentine's Day.
But that shows how much you love her, yeah? Come on.
That shows how much you have to work and make more money. It's a very competitive business model. You have got the same brands within your stores. You have got the same brands standalone. You have got the same brands in competition superstores. So how do you differentiate and make sure that the customer retains with you?
See, there are only two words. In fact, I would say there's only one word, and that is experience. And experience is very relative. I mean, you can't customize an experience for the mass. It has to be individual experiences. And if you look at it, like I said, 73-74% of the business comes from known customers. So I don't know whether we are loyal to the customers or the customers are loyal to us. But this whole sharing of experience, sharing of openness, being transparent with the customers actually helped us. So it has nothing to do with the price. It's nothing to do with the value. I think it's to do with the presentation, assortment, and knowing the customer and trying to help. For example, if those of you who follow the markets, I mean, last quarter, Shoppers delivered a 17% like-to-like sales in spite of online hitting you so badly. So I think if your connections with the customers are right, it actually happens.
In 2008, 2010, that patch, the whole world went through the turmoil of downturns. And everybody learned lessons which helped them either to exist or perish. What were your learnings in that downtimes?
I think two learnings. One learning is in a market like India, where you're dealing with Indian customers with Indian revenues, but we almost have reached European costs. I think you have to learn the way Europeans in the Western world works. With 1% growth, they are still able to show 10% profits. I think in India, what's happened is with 10% growth, we actually escalate our cost by 12 to 15%. So somewhere at the board level, we said, can we really work out every time, every year thinking there's a downturn? So every year when you're saying 12% growth, you say, okay, no. Work out your cost on the basis of 8% growth, but look at the revenue as a 12% growth. It actually helps you. Second is retail is a penny business. Chahe aap $1 billion karo ya $10 billion karo, ginna ek rupaya padta hai. So if you are a penny business, you have to learn to work like a penny. And I think that's very, very critical.
Inventory management is a very key aspect of any retail type of a business model. So what were the strategies that you adopt for inventory management?
One is the technology made a lot of difference. Don't forget that when you're talking of this scale, you're talking of 1,500 crores of inventory. And you're talking of millions of SKUs lying. I know from that jhumka of 20 rupees to a 25,000 rupees sari and suit. So I think technology is important because it's working capital converted in technology. That's number one. Number two is your employees should know the importance of the inventory that you have. The third is a connected business with the vendors make a lot of difference. Like I told you, that the whole business works on auto-replenishment, which means there's no interference. Somebody can auto-replenish. The vendors know the inventory. Now, of course, the model is that almost 40 to 50% of the business is what they call as concessioner. So the inventory is with the vendors and not with the company.
How did you plan e-commerce to be the strength of a retail store, retail organization? Because e-commerce, when it came, it was a threat to all organizations. They started feeling that now every human being in this country is going to buy online. So how did you take that system when it came up? Last 7-8 years, I think e-commerce has been spoken about a lot. So how did you make it your strength rather than your weakness?
Actually, not many people know that we were actually the first brick and mortar guys to start online as early as 1998. Okay, but we didn't have the guts because when we went and presented to the board and said, we have a business where we can do a 1 crore, but it's going to burn 10 crores. I mean, we all became nervous. Yeah. So we started and we closed. And now it's been a late entry. But if you go around the world, the biggest and the most profitable businesses in retail are the omni-channel business. Whether it is Saks, whether it is John Lewis in UK. So India also, you'll find a lot of omni-channel players who are doing online and offline both. I think Shoppers in the next 12 to 18 months will be an omni-channel player. And you'll actually see them serving the customers 24/7. through online and offline. And as far as the competition is concerned, it is very, very welcome. Because actually it has put the whole offline players on the toes. Because nobody ever thought that the online is going to hit so much. And I think we are getting prepared for it.
What has competition taught you?
Competition has taught you to keep your eyes open 24/7. Because we have to watch. Competition has also taught us, and we have learned a lesson, that every time you can't be just thinking about competition, because many times you think of competition and forget about looking at your own business. And that's actually happening. Second is that customer never gives it all. And no retailer can take it all. So every time you feel that wo customer chala gaya hai, jaise wo aapka customer uske paas chala gaya hai, same other customer can come. So I'm saying in retail business, service business, by all business, if you have a very strong customer centricity, chances of losing the customer becomes less. And how do you transfer the customer centricity from the top man to the bottom, or from the bottom to the top?
I'm sure you believe in innovation. Can you discuss an innovation that really was a first mover advantage in the retail space?
Let me first tell you the process of innovation that we adopted, okay, which is slightly different. At least when we were operating, when I was operating the business, nobody in a meeting could use the word no. The word no was banned in a meeting. The moment you say, we want to do that, no sir, it cannot happen. Or no sir. We have said, every time you do a meeting, you have to start with the word yes. I mean, you are a developer. So you will say, we are going to do 10 lakh square feet, but sell at 1,000 rupees a square foot. What will be the answer? No. But he has to say first yes. Yes, then he has to use the word but. How many employees would like to use the word in front of a boss? So it actually started in triggering positive thinking. To me, that is a very critical part of the whole innovation. Innovation has been the part of Shoppers Stop in terms of its thinking. Whether it was starting at 2,800 square feet, whether it was the whole black and white campaign. We are the only fashion retailer in the world who for 25 years have not used color in our campaign, but have been selling fashion which is all colorful. I mean, this is a bold step. Uska bhi ek kahani hai, time hoga toh bataunga. It's a
now, what is the story between the black and white logo?
Well, the story is that this campaign, when it was being done by contract agency and sent it to me, I loved the campaign. But I had only 19 lakhs budget. And they kept telling me on the phone, this campaign is so beautiful, you love it, it'll cost 56 lakhs. So I said, boss, mere paas 19 lakhs. Finally, I asked him, why should a black and white campaign cost 19 lakhs? He said, sir, ye toh colored campaign hai. I said, ye black and white hai. Nahi, colored hai. He had sent me a colored campaign, I had a black and white fax.
The fax saved you so many lakhs.
Not so many lakhs then, it has saved us so many crores.
Till today.
Absolutely. So what we loved it, we retained it, and it is carried on. People, you know, they say your big strategies, you know, what strategy? It's all hindsight. It's all hindsight.
So you're an accidental innovative person.
I don't know. I think I'm an accidental person as far as Shoppers Stop is concerned, because I didn't tell you the story. When I was running Shoppers Stop with 500 square feet, you know, I always used to dream ki 50,000 square feet ka dukaan khulna chahiye. I think I told you that. Yeah, and my boss met somebody who's a friend of Rahejas and said, wo ek pagal hai wahan, Bangalore mein baith ke bolta 50,000 square feet ka dukaan chalayenge. And there was no 50,000 square feet ka dukaan. And Rahejas told him ki yaar, humare paas 50,000 square feet ka dukaan, usko leke ao. So I came here first time and in 20 minutes he selected. So I am an accidental employee also for it. But that's the way it happened.
What are the next steps that you did once you expanded from Bombay? How did you do your market survey before venturing into a new virgin market?
That was not very difficult because two things happened. One is you know that the cities have been growing. The top five metro cities were the first available. We had the first mover, so we got better properties. The second is, although we were selling out of only Shoppers Stop in Andheri, but we started getting a lot of customers from all over the country. And since we had a First Citizens Club, we almost knew that if we go to Hyderabad, you already have 10,000 First Citizens. Okay, so we would actually talk to them. So we had the advantage of talking to our prospective customers even before entering the place. And after that, it was all about looking at analytics, looking at the catchment and doing those things. But we do have made mistakes because location, location, location is the key. So I would say we hit probably 8 on 10 or 9 on 10 in terms of good location, but we've had failures.
From the retail space, I think you made it like a movement. Like you started the trust for the retail organizations. You brought almost 21 countries together. You created award platforms. What was the reason behind that and how successful have you been in that?
I don't know. I think my dad influenced in this journey of mine. And I took a call when I was 45 that at the age of 50, I'll step out. And I said, this is 25 years of learning, 25 years of earning, and 25 years of returning. So when I turned 50, I said, it's all going to be my returning phase. But I think the bigger learning for me is, because I had taken that call, and I knew that the Rahejas are not going to run Shop to Stop. They're very involved, but they don't run directly. At the age of 45, when I took this call, I did tell the board that allow me to help with succession. And to me, I think that is extremely important. I mean, this is a message I definitely would want to pass to the audience, is that every day, or at least every week, I mean, whatever suits you, think that you're going to die tomorrow. And think, what is it that, what will happen to the organization? What can you do? So one is, you'll enjoy today very well. Because aapko agar pata hai ki kal last din hai, to aaj to enjoy karoge aap. Yeah. The second thing is that then you know that you have created a succession which can run larger than you and longer than you. So to me, let go is a very important part of the business. And that helped me in actually building this. Because this was my journey towards giving back, therefore I started this trust, wanting to see if employees who work in retail, there are 3.5 crores, 35 million people who work in retail. So my trust actually works for that. In 4.5 years, we've reached global. Last year, we had about 40 lakh people who celebrated Retail Employees Day in India and Turkey. And of course, we have 25 centers for disabled youth that we run. This year, we'll have 1,600 disabled youth who will get livelihood in the retail business. We train employees at $1 a class. This year, we would have ended up training 5,500 employees. It's growing exponentially, but it's a
fantastic.
It's a beautiful journey.
You also nominated 12th December as the Global Retail Day, and it gets celebrated. You started competition for the best sales associate, and I think in the first year the championship was won by somebody from Germany, somebody in Selfridges in London, and somebody at Macy's in the US. So I think these are some great initiatives as a pioneer, as a first mover advantage. You did it for this particular industry, and India, if I'm not mistaken, employs more than 3.5 crore people who are engaged in the retail business. That's right. What's your mission forward?
Well, by 2020, we want to impact 1 million people in terms of the livelihood. But number is more a challenge. You know, you have to keep number to excite yourself. I think it's not a number game. Every youth who goes through the impact actually makes a difference to 4 more people. So it's a huge journey. Number is not important. I think the journey is to say, how can we really build again an institution which can last longer than my life? Like I said, Shop to Stop has lasted longer than my life. Retail associations lasted longer. My journey is to see if I can make the trust self-sustain and be on its own. The journey has just begun, Rajesh. I think it's a long way to go for me.
One last question from me before I open it to the house for asking questions. What are your performance management systems in the organization?
Yeah, I think this is something that we have always looked at it right from beginning. I mean, each person has to be accountable for what they do. The only different thing that we did very, very early is we actually have 2 cycles of performance management. One during September, October, half yearly, which is actually potential rather than performance. And one during March, which is actually performance. So when we are sitting in September, October, we are looking at saying, what is the potential that you have? What can you do? What is your ambition? How can you grow? How can we make you grow? No discussions on financials, no discussions on performance, no discussions on increments. But when we sit in March, April, it is absolutely clear that it is all about performance, it's about increments. Plus, because we had ESOPs in the company for the top management, we had brought the ESOP cycle in June and bonus cycle in October. So, har 3 mahine mein kuch na kuch hota rehta tha. So, for somebody to even think of leaving is, arey yaar, mera performance management increment jayega, or mera bonus ka time aayega, mera ESOP ka time aayega, mera promotion ka time aayega. So, it almost became part of the life. But we also use the balanced scorecard method for performance management very early, about 14, 15 years back, we adopted it. That's the way we measure people.
Fantastic. I think that needs a round of applause for the speaker. We'll open up the house for questions. I think Advocate Nikhil has a question to begin with. Generally, advocates have answers. They'll have a question.
There are 2 questions. One, since you have been in the retail for the last 20 years, probably a question that everybody asks. Hello. Sorry, the local Baniya Dukan in 20 years, would it survive or would it be a goodbye? My second question is, I don't know if I'm right, but 2005, 2004, I think you all were intending to diversify your business and move into the automobile space and take automobiles. I don't know if I'm right on that, but something told me that you all were into that, I suppose, but just want to know if you all are still in the pipeline of it.
No, the second part is not right. Okay, there was no, at least in Shop to Stop, there was nothing to do with automobile. On the first part, People say that kiranas have died. There's no evidence even today that they have died. Please understand that the growth of the overall business is much larger than the size of the modern business. Okay, just to give you 500 billion, it's 530, but I'm taking a round figure, is growing by 7%, which means that the consumption is getting added by $35 billion a year. The total modern trade is 4%. So the pie is growing bigger than the share. So absolutely there's no issue. What's happening is that most of the kiranas and the smaller people are actually now 50, 55, 60 year old. They are not so educated. They have actually educated the children. So second generation which is coming is not wanting to do the same business. So many of them are actually getting into newer businesses, franchise, go linking road, everything is franchised. Okay, a lot of them are getting into optical. If you go to opticians, most of the opticians are sons or children of people who are running kirana businesses, because that's the way they're getting into modern. We don't see a threat, because this is a nation of shopkeepers. India doesn't have place to put big formats. I mean, if you want to put 20 hyper cities in this city, will you please get me a property at 25 rupees a square foot rental? No way. He charges 25 rupees a cam, a square foot. So there's no way you can operate the business.
And Rajas will not allow that.
So it is
Sidhu.
It is,
yeah. Yes, Sidhu.
Good evening, sir. My question to you is, what are your suggestions for a startup who wants to enter into retail business or to get into a big retail store?
So as of today, the first thing is get your proposition right. What is it that you want to sell? Second is get your target customer right, because everybody is enamored by this India growing, you know, the demographic dividend, and everybody wants to sell to 18 to 25. Unlike in the West, 18 to 25 in India don't work. They will stay with the parents. So there's very little money there. That's the second. The third is don't make your business model, if you're looking at large, becoming big, only on the basis of brick and mortar. Please get in and participate with the consumer's life. Suppose if you're dealing with the 65 to 75 year old Indian, then you don't have to get online. But if you're dealing with an 18 to 25 or a 25 to 35, I mean, you can't escape the online. So you have to get into this. That's the third. The last is that the first pilot that you do, ensure that you make the model very, very successful. Or at least you know what the model looks like, then replicate. The last is India is Europe. Nobody enters Europe together. You always go to Italy, France, Germany, UK. When you enter India, don't like to enter India all over. Unfortunately, anybody who enters India opens first store in Delhi, second in Bombay, third in Bangalore. No, you can actually open 50 stores in Mumbai. I mean, I can tell you Natural Salon, which is a salon shop. I mean, out of 330 stores, 300 is in Chennai alone. One city has 300 salons. So India has got a lot of depth. Use that as an opportunity.
Fantastic, yes.
Hi. Basically, I'm a vendor of the Hypercity. So last 6 months back, we started one store and we got a good amount of business. And now we are opening a two store in Bombay, Viviana and Vashi in Orbit. The question is the same, the offline and online, because we are into furniture and kitchen. So our store expenses would be lakhs of rupees. So in future, the Hypercity, they are giving an opportunity to open our outlets in entire India, throughout India. So the concern is walk-ins are some in the occasion of like 26th January or 15th August, all the snap deals on Amazon are giving a big, big advertisement. So walking systems are, you know, that amount of time, it's very less. So we are just wondering ki, what will be effect in future in of online market and offline market.
You should be selling on Snap. If you are selling in Hypercity, you should also be selling in Snapdeal, Flipkart and Amazon. Number one. Okay. There's no reason for you not to sell with them. You can become a vendor of theirs. Number two is you have to decide whether you want to get a large turnover or make money. Okay, that's the decision. What would you like to do? Make money or sell more?
Answer carefully, you're on camera.
No.
You have to answer what your customer will like to hear.
But look at it, he's thinking, yaar. Why should you be thinking? You should say, I want to make money.
No, yeah, people are coming for the business for making money only.
No, it's a different thing. If you're making too much money, I'll not go and tell Hypercity to get you cut your commission. I won't do that. I'm not that involved. No, the important thing is, as entrepreneurs, we should know what is it we want to achieve. Okay, and let me tell you, if you have a successful business model, If you do a 1 crore sale at 1 lakh profit, you're likely to get a better valuation than if you do 10 crore sale and 5 crores loss. And everybody is only looking at Flipkart, Amazon, and Snapdeal because that's what everybody is talking, the media is talking about. To me, the opportunity is there to make business. If your customer is online and offline, you have no business to just be in offline. You have to be an online. So the simplest thing is follow your customer. Know your customer and follow your customer.
Yes, Vivek. Who has a question? Rohit.
Yeah, good evening, Nagesh.
Hi.
Yeah, I have two questions. One is, you know, if we just see around, many malls are just closing down. In fact, where I stay, Mulund West, Nirmal Lifestyle, Shopper Stop is the only brand remaining there. So reason why it is that, and is it taking the negative impact on your brand? And question two is, if we look at the all the online business, and look at the valuation kind thing, and the billions of dollars are being pumped. So how realistic is that, or is it just going to be a bubble?
Okay, on the first question, two things have happened. One is, operating is a mall is not building a residential property and selling it. I think this is one of the mistakes that most developers made. Operating a mall is almost running a five-star hotel or running a hospital. I mean, 24/7. Most developers, with due respect, are not used to servicing customers. They're used to selling, signing an agreement and giving it off. So developers who do not have the mentality to run and serve a mall are not able to manage the mall. That's number one. Second is the way the mall was managed, it went off. Shopper Stop was the first customer, and we're still standing. We're the last person standing there. Okay, but we would also probably, business will take a call. Malls will go, a lot of them may get redeveloped into something else, but we'll again see a cycle of malls coming. India will require almost 10 times the malls that we have. The size and the format of the malls will change. They will not be so large. So you'll find a change in the way the malls will happen. As far as the online business is concerned, online business will be a very important component of this country. I mean, you will see 18, 20, 25% of the shopping Indians will do online. But we also believe Indians will do online as well as offline. So online is here to stay. We have no option. We will continue. A lot of people who are not productive, people who do not understand the business will fall off. So weaker partners will actually fall off.
That long, long run business where you will start making profits after 10, 15, 20 years?
No, as far as they are concerned, actually many of us don't understand the business model as of today. But we also feel that some of them may get consolidated. Because in 5 to 10 years, but don't forget that the investors are backing them. So somebody like you who's got a lot of money is actually backing them. So we have to actually understand their business model. And because of Alibaba and Amazon's success, everybody believes that there'll be another Alibaba, Amazon. But there's only one Alibaba, one Amazon. So we'll have one large player in India emerging. Others, there would be some challenges there.
We will be taking last four questions. Yes, Anto.
Yeah, good evening. You mentioned that you know got a turnover of about 4,000 crores and inventory of about 1,500 crores. That translates to approximately 2.5 to 3 times of ITR. Is it typically
about 3 to 4 times in fashion business?
Right.
Sorry, you complete the question.
And now you mentioned that you know you have transferred the inventory burden onto the vendors. So by keeping such an inventory, are they able to make money as well? That's my first question. Second question will be that, you know, out of your total 4,000 crores, what will be the contribution of the sales season?
Well, to me, typically the sales is to be run between 8 weeks to 12 weeks. Now the sales have actually gone into, I would say, close to about 12 to 16 weeks. So if you look at it, all retailers, they've extended the sale period. Okay, I may not have a correct picture on the contribution of the sales because, like I said, I'm not running the business for the last 5 years. That's one important part of it. As far as the inventory is concerned, fashion inventory turns between 3 to 4 times in this country. The ideal is to run at about 6 times a year. And people fast fashion like the Zaras of the world, I'm told, run between 9 to 12 times a year.
Yes, Vivek.
Good evening, sir. Great fan of yours. You know my face. Sir, I want to share a small story. I'm from Lawrence, sorry. So when you started Retail Association of India, my company became a member in the first 10 checks. And we received a call asking that, why did you become a member? So I said, because of B.S. Nagesh, Noel Tata, and Kishore Biyani. And I think you've held the testimony of time of doing a wonderful organization. Sitting next to me is Mr. Lancy. And he deals in big containers. But many of the audience don't know is what you have done with containers. And I will want everyone, you to share it with everyone. The train story about with containers. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah, we started our first classroom in a container converted. Idea was that retail employees cannot afford to come to a class. So I said, if they can't come to a class, I'll take the class to them. They said they can't afford to spend money. So I said, how much can you spend? So they said, we can spend 60, 65 rupees a class. So I said, we'll convert the class into $1 a class. So we started this whole program where we train people at $1 a class. We started with container. Today we don't have any containers, no classrooms. We train people in 30 cities, 50 cities at $1 a class, 60 to 90 rupees depending on it. And like I said, last year we have trained about 5,000 people. As it goes, this year could be about 15,000 employees. I think we created a lot of challenges and restraint for ourselves. And we are a very, very small team. My trust team is 7 of us. 6.5, because they 6 work full-time, I work half-time. So it's amazing as to what can happen. Like I said, if you believe that, you know, let me put it the other way. You know, instead of pushne se ki kya ho sakta hai, ask the question, kyun nahi ho sakta hai? And everything is possible. Everything is possible.
Yeah, Geeta.
Yeah. There's a live case study of Landmark, you must be knowing. They're the pioneers of the largest bookstores. And they sold the business at the right time. And when they turned back, the bookstores were all taken over by the online. There's no bookstores which is doing well now. So what would happen to the garment retail industry in terms of online coming behind like that?
Let me ask the question to you. You look very fashionable. Okay. Will you, not today, will you buy all your clothes in the future only from online? No. So we believe that we'll have a lots of people like you. We'll have a lots of people like your friends who are going to online. But one thing I use the word, the customer never gives it all and the retailer never gets it all. And this is an established fact. The world's largest retailer, Walmart, largest, $500 billion turnover, has 10% market share of their home market, US.
So, but still for their costing, haven't they shrunk? I mean, when you go to a Walmart store now and 10 years back, yes, the energy is low, yes, the business is low, you're able to feel it.
Absolutely, absolutely. So there's a
so
new
how
trend.
Does it work for your cost? Your cost is a running cost and you have
you
such huge rent.
You have to accordingly adopt. So some brick and mortar retailers have scaled down from a 40,000 square feet, they have done 30,000 square feet. From having 100 people, they have scaled down to 80 people, use technology. From only getting the customer into the store, now they are also doing home delivery. So everybody is remodeling, and once we have the online, and that's why I use the word John Lewis, okay, once you have an online and an omni-channel business, then what you can do is something online player cannot do. Just imagine, buy online, collect offline, try offline, buy online, return offline. I mean, look at the immense possibility that happens if you could have 24/7 a Shopper Stop next to you or a Landmark or a Crossword.
So you have to adapt to the customer 24/7.
There's no option.
Yeah.
There's no option. Your local baniya is adopting to it. You're adopting. I mean, today we are adopting to the way our husbands and wives behave with each other. So where is the question of not adopting to this?
Last question. One last question. Yes, Ralph.
Rajesh talked about inventory management. I'm sure you have something superb, ERP like SAP or Oracle. I believe there's a lot of theft in organized retail as well. And I believe it's more than 2%, probably. Correct me if I'm wrong. And how do you manage the margin shrinking, the online coming in and all that? So how do you keep your theft low?
So the Indian market average, although it is not published, is roughly about 1.4, 1.5%. And this 1.5% shrinkage is broken into three parts. One is technical errors. A vendor sells 100 but has only sent 99, so one shot. Employee theft, which is almost one third. And customer shoplifting, which is one third. So it's almost one third, one third, one third. If you go and look at the annual report of Shopper Stop for the last 17, 18 years, our shrinkage has been in the region of 0.4 to 0.5%. Okay, the technical part we've literally removed, because of the mechanisms and the technology that we use. We actually have an incentive system which ensures, or at least to a great extent, that the employee theft is reduced. Because they know that if you have shrinkage, it goes out of the total profitability pool, and therefore their bonuses will come down. Okay, so that is to some extent controlled. Shoplifting, happens, But then you have various measures, including cameras, including, you know, vigilant employees and staff. But the shoplifting is part of the customers. Off the camera, if you want me to tell you stories of how people shoplift, that'd be a very interesting one to talk about it.
Thanks, Nagesh. That was excellent. I think we are at the end of the session. We would like to thank the speaker. And well, I would request you to stand for a few minutes. Since they all know you, I would definitely request you to know all of them. So I would like to introduce them. Sure, please, please.
I must say that I've had the opportunity of speaking, interacting in many places around the world. Okay, but this has been a unique experience. I was telling him, you know, before coming, he says, andhera kar do, you know, no lights and all that. And I was telling this was to happen in the hostel. Jab kisi ko marna hota tha na, to andhere mein, andar le ja ke, kambal chada ke usko thaad, thaad, thaad. So I almost got the feeling like that, but fortunately, Manak is known to me, so Manak was accompanying me. So when you have a Sardar next to you, you feel more safe. Yeah?
But knowing you, I'm sure you are never the victim.
Never that. And I must also compliment you because, I mean, you never allowed me to take breath. I mean, this is like real rapid
fire. I lost the game. You took the breath. Thanks a lot, Nagesh. So friends, it was wonderful having you all here. I would like to request Mr. Chandurkar to come up on the stage, please, to give a memento to our chief guest. When we give the mug, we take a promise. All liquids should be used in this cup only.
Define all liquids.